Près de 70% de la population
mondiale. Close to 70% of the world population lives nowadays in urban spaces. However, although wealth is concentrated in towns, there are also many poor people in towns and the environment is degraded. The matter of urban sustainability is therefore a major challenge for the 20th century. Now, the issue is that implementation is very difficult. It's easier said than done. Sustainability is often thought about only through technical exemplary solutions, things that are easier to implement and things that are politically much more visible, smart grids, eco-efficient buildings, green transport, greening of roofs and houses. However, when this approach does not think about the town as a whole, and when it doesn't really think about how livable the town will be, is usually unsuccessful, as can be seen on this slide. Sustainability is not just about sciences, it's about ideas, values, standards. The environment is not something that should be taken for granted. It must be built and developed by societies. A polluted environment is maybe something where people like to live. Look at how much people are prepared to spend to live in the heart of the biggest metropolis in the world. Conversely, an environment outside of town when there is clean air and clean water can be very difficult to live in. There are building complexes outside of town in the suburbs where it's impossible to live, although it's not in town. Therefore, the efficacy of a sustainable planning policy is based on the fact that the population adheres to the program. Therefore, before anything is done, one should define what is the right environment for a given society. The environment where better environmental conditions could be achieved, better quality of water, air, biodiversity, good resource management, wise use of energy. And by improving environmental conditions, we can achieve improvement of living conditions. What inhabitants are we really talking about? Urban dwellers, where do they start, where do they stop? Two things. For the last 50 years, all efforts made to limit urban expansion are still characterized by fragmentation and spreading of urban areas. Whichever institutional configuration we're talking about, whichever political configuration, demographic configuration we're talking about, there must be some reason. The second thing is that we all imagine towns in history with a very dense center and then the suburbs. This is what we think about when we want to promote sustainable urban planning. These centers can only survive if they export from outside the resources they need and export towards the outside the waste and everything else. And a large part of the population that is no longer wealthy enough to live in town. According to David Pierce, towns are in a situation of imported sustainability. Therefore, we must think of in sustainability on sufficiently large territories so that we can include imported sustainability. For each town, the urban transition towards sustainability must be taken as a whole, including urban centers, urbanized suburbs, and peri-urban areas or natural spaces close to towns. And how can we think about sustainability of such a whole set of things which are really a haphazard mix of different things? For instance, take natural spaces, forests, or rural land, which seem to be very exotic when they are present in an urban structure. Well, maybe they could form a kind of green grid. Forests can be the connection between fragmented urban spaces. In Denmark, forests are the link between built spaces with a real leisure value and environmental value. They absorb CO2s and they absorb nitrates from aquifers, they improve biodiversity, and they also provide leisure spaces for the population. As I was saying earlier, a fundamental aspect in sustainability is the relationship that the town dwellers have with their environment. Sustainable urban areas, therefore, require that new spaces are invented for spatial organization and socialization. It is absolutely essential that a multifunctional network combines housing, shops, services, agriculture, industry, and leisure activities. By combining the interests of the dwellers and the players, we can, for instance, encourage the creation of micro companies or in wasteland or micro gardens with a very positive impact on the landscape, as can be seen on the slide. The whole point is to loosen the very strict legislative framework to exit a system that divides the land into single functional areas. For instance, here we have wasteland which can be opened and used for a new type of function, possibly even considering that transitory uses can become permanent. Here we have single functional areas such as shopping malls or supermarkets or suburb housing complexes, and you have a very good example on this picture of a very welcoming place or very intensive agricultural areas. Well, inhabitants find a way to use this differently. For instance, in parking lots, they organize carpooling or meeting places. There are street vendors. There are techno music festivals organized in the fields, or some farmers organize scrapyards, illegal scrap yards, and people organize handicraft or offices in garages. We've had a very good example of an improvised company organized in the garage. So it is about time that we take into account the self-organized dynamic, of course, slightly unbalanced, but still capable of functioning.